Let's pray together. Our Father, we are thankful for who you are and for what you've done. Lord, you are great beyond description. Age to age you stand. Time is in your hands. You never change. Everything about us changes. Everything about our world changes. You never change. And we give you thanks and praise, Father. You are the only rock, the only foundation. And we praise you for making yourself known to us in your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for the band. Thank you for this music. Thank you for everyone that's come. And Lord, would you help me today to preach your word in a way that would glorify your Son. Open every heart, every ear to hear this morning. This I ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Amen. You can be seated, everybody. As we continue to move through Judges, some things are becoming pretty obvious, aren't they? And one of the most obvious is that worshiping idols must have been really, really attractive. Because no matter how much it hurt Israel, they kept doing it. No matter how much trouble it brought them, they kept going back to other gods. So we're going to walk through the story this morning like we've been doing this next judge named Jephthah. We're going to draw out the implications for us again at the end. But as we read through, notice in the story that the details of idolatry, as you move through Judges, get more and more attention. You know, everything that they cause, everything that's going on because of them, the reasons they're going after them, the focus on that becomes clearer and sharper. The structure of Judges, you can probably see it, is pretty deliberate, right? The writer gives us two main sets of judges. You have the first set, or these deliverers. The first set was Othniel, Ehud, and then Deborah and Barak. Those stories were very straightforward. They're fairly brief. We don't get very many personal details about the judges at all. We don't have really any blatant negative commentary on them or their decisions, and each one of their stories end very quickly, generally very positively. But the second group, the group that started with Gideon, and then today is Jephthah, and then we start Samson next week, are much different. They're probably the ones we're much more familiar with. We get much more detail in their stories. You get much more about their character and the kind of men they were. And you get increasingly negative commentary on the things they did. And all three of those cycles, all three of them end in tragedy that just gets worse. And so the author starts to stress their imperfections of these judges, their faults, their inability to finally or completely save the people. And that's where we pick up Jephthah. Now, it's been bad. It's about to get really bad as we read. And so we have those familiar, depressing words again at the start in 10:6. The verses will be here if you don't have your Bible with you. The people of Israel again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals and the Ashtoreth, the gods of Syria, the gods of Sidon, the gods of Moab, the gods of the Ammonites, and the gods of the Philistines. And they forsook the Lord and did not serve him. So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he sold them into the hand of the Philistines and into the hand of the Ammonites, and they crushed and oppressed the people of Israel that year. For 18 years, they oppressed all the people of Israel who were beyond the Jordan in the land of the Amorites, which is in Gilead. And the Ammonites crossed the Jordan to fight also against Judah and against Benjamin and against the house of Ephraim, so that Israel was severely distressed. And the people of Israel cried out to the Lord, saying, "We have sinned against you, because we have forsaken our God and have served the Baals." And the Lord said to the people of Israel, "Did I not save you from the Egyptians and from the Amorites, from the Ammonites and from the Philistines? The Sidonians also and the Amalekites and the Maonites oppressed you, and you cried out to me, and I saved you out of their hand. Yet you have forsaken me and served other gods. Therefore, I will save you no more." Verse 14, "Go and cry out to the gods whom you have chosen. Let them save you in the time of your distress." Thank God for Jesus Christ, by the way. Verse 15, and the people of Israel said to the Lord, we have sinned. Do to us whatever seems good to you. Only please deliver us this day. So they put away the foreign gods from among them and served the Lord. And he became impatient over the misery of Israel. So you get this picture of how far Israel has fallen. It's total disaster. Israel worships everybody's idols. The Baals and the Ashtoreth, that first description, those were the gods of the native Canaanites. But the gods of Syria, in some translations it says Aram, this region which Syria was in, they're from the northwest. The gods of Sidon, they're from the north. The gods of Moab and Ammon, they're from the east. The gods of the Philistines, they're from the south. All of those people are outside of Canaan proper. They would come in and oppress the Israelites. So the author is telling us every time Israel worshiped the gods of a nation, that nation ended up oppressing and enslaving them. And God has had enough. He sold them into the hands of the Philistines and the Ammonites. Now, it doesn't mean God was abandoning them or going back on his promises to them, but it does mean, at least in some way, that he stops protecting them. He let what they were serving actually own them. And it's their worst oppression yet. They're crushed. Remember, he said they're oppressed, severely distressed. So they cry out again. But God has heard all of this before. We've read it over and over and over again. His response is much heavier than it was even in chapter 6. Remember, right before Gideon, they cried out to the Lord, and God sent a prophet instead of a savior right away. And this time, he literally says, no, I won't help. Cry out to the God you've been worshiping. God knows what that cry is. He knows the heart that it comes from. It's just a cry for help to anybody that will listen. And God is saying, look, you can address those to the Baals that you worship for all that that's worth. They're treating God like one of their idols. You know, push the right buttons, say the stuff you're supposed to say, make the right sacrifices, then the God will help them. The heart makes no difference whatsoever in the worshiping of an idol. But God says, I will save you no more. So in verse 15, Israel is obviously stunned by this, and it looks like they finally turn, even if it's just for a moment. It looks like they actually repent and put away the foreign gods. Notice what they're in essence saying in verse 15. Look, we want to serve you, even if it means we have to keep suffering, but we'd rather not. Could you please help us? And God becomes, the text says, impatient over their misery. So I don't know, I really don't, if Israel literally repented here or not. It doesn't say that God is responding because they repented. It says that he is growing impatient over their misery. And that's just a little snapshot of the heart of our God, the compassion of our God. Verse 17, then the Ammonites were called to arms and they encamped in Gilead. And the people of Israel came together and they encamped at Mizpah. And the people, the leaders of Gilead, said one to another, who is the man who will begin to fight against the Ammonites? He shall be head over all the inhabitants of Gilead. So the Ammonites are getting ready to attack Israel in Gilead, and the leaders in Gilead are looking for that deliverer. They're looking for the leader, for the one that will save them. That brings us into chapter 11, verse 1. Now Jephthah the Gileadite was a mighty warrior, but he was the son of a prostitute. Gilead was the father of Jephthah. And Gilead's wife also bore him sons. And when his wife's sons grew up, they drove Jephthah out and said to him, you shall not have an inheritance in our father's house, for you are the son of another woman. Then Jephthah fled from his brothers and lived in the land of Tob, and worthless fellows collected around Jephthah and went out with him. After a time, the Ammonites made war against Israel. That's what we're reading. And when the Ammonites made war against Israel, the elders of Gilead went to bring Jephthah from the land of Tob, this mighty warrior. And they said to Jephthah, come and be our leader that we may fight against the Ammonites. But Jephthah said to the elders of Gilead, did you not hate me and drive me out of my father's house? Why have you come to me now when you are in distress? And the elders of Gilead said to Jephthah, this is why we have turned to you now, that you may go with us and fight against the Ammonites and be our head over all the inhabitants of Gilead. Jephthah said to the elders of Gilead, if you bring me home again to fight against the Ammonites and the Lord gives them over to me, I will be your head. And the elders of Gilead said to Jephthah, the Lord will be witness between us if we do not do as you say. So Jephthah went with the elders of Gilead, and the people made him head and leader over them. And Jephthah spoke all his words before the Lord at Mizpah. So basically, Gilead is out of options. Okay, the Ammonites are about to attack. They have nowhere to turn. They're going to have to go to the one they rejected and thrown out. They're going to have to go to the illegitimate son of his father's affair with a prostitute. So when it came to that, Israel wanted to have standards. The guerrilla fighter, the man with the gang, the outlaw named Jephthah will have to be their savior. Now, maybe you noticed it as we read through, but the similarities between the way Israel treats Yahweh and the way Gilead treats Jephthah are way too close to be coincidences. When the Israelites are in a jam, what do? They call out to the Lord they've been rejecting. Just like the leaders of Gilead who are in a jam cry out to Jephthah, who they've rejected, to bail them out. So both the Lord and Jephthah know they're being used. They know what's going on. The story of Jephthah, again then, is a little picture of the heart of all Israel. Everything you see in him is a picture of what's really going on in the heart of Israel, the true condition of where the people are. That's what the stories do. You get a picture of the whole nation, the whole heart, through the lens of this broken, messed up judge. The men of Gilead have to be saved, so they seek that salvation from the very one they had cast out and rejected. So Jephthah begins his conflict with the king of the Ammonites in chapter 11, verse 12. Then Jephthah sent messengers to the king of the Ammonites and said, "What do you have against me that you have come to me to fight against my land?" And the king of the Ammonites answered the messengers of Jephthah, "Because Israel, on coming up from Egypt, took away my land from the Arnon to the Jabbok and to the Jordan. Now, therefore, restore it peaceably." Jephthah again sent messengers to the king of the Ammonites and said to him, "Thus says Jephthah, Israel did not take away the land of Moab or the land of the Ammonites, but when they came up from Egypt, Israel went through the wilderness to the Red Sea and came to Kadesh. Israel then sent messengers to the king of Edom saying, 'Please let us pass through your land.' But the king of Edom would not listen. And they sent also to the king of Moab, but he would not consent. So Israel remained at Kadesh." So this isn't just a dumb brute. This guy knows his history. Verse 18. "Then they journeyed through the wilderness and went around the land of Edom and the land of Moab and arrived on the east side of the land of Moab and camped on the other side of the Arnon. But they did not enter the territory of Moab, for the Arnon was the boundary of Moab. Israel then sent messengers to Sihon, king of the Amorites, king of Heshbon, and Israel said to him, 'Please let us pass through your land to our country.' But Sihon did not trust Israel to pass through his territory. So Sihon gathered all his people together and encamped at Jahaz and fought with Israel. And the Lord, the God of Israel, gave Sihon and all his people into the hand of Israel, and they defeated them. So Israel took possession of all the land of the Amorites who inhabited that country. And they took possession of all the territory of the Amorites, from the Arnon to the Jabbok and from the wilderness to the Jordan. So then the Lord, the God of Israel, dispossessed the Amorites from before his people Israel. And are you to take possession of them? Will you not possess what Chemosh your God gives you to possess? And all that the Lord our God has dispossessed before us, we will possess. Now are you any better than Balak, the son of Zippor, king of Moab? Did he ever contend against Israel, or did he ever go to war with them? While Israel lived in Heshbon and its villages and in Aroer and its villages and in all the cities that are on the banks of the Arnon 300 years, why did you not deliver them within that time? I therefore have not sinned against you, and you do me wrong by making war on me. The Lord, the judge, decide this day between the people of Israel and the people of Ammon." So Jephthah doesn't go to war right away. Turns out he's very smart, knows his salvation history very well. The Ammonite king comes and says to them that he's come to attack Israel because part of the land they're on now used to belong to them. He said, this is Ammonite land. Jephthah argues that the king is wrong. First, because of history. When Israel came up from Egypt, the Edomites and the Moabites lived in this land south of Arnon. Israel asked for permission to pass through. They refused. So they traveled toward the land north of the Arnon, south of the Jabbok rivers, where the Amorites lived under King Sihon. So Sihon attacked the Israelites. Israel wins the battle. They win the land by conquest, fair and square. That land, where they're on now then, never belonged to the Ammonites, was never their land. They lived north of the Jabbok rivers. It had previously belonged to the Amorites, and Israel won it from them, like we said, fair and square. Next, so he argues because of history. Then Jephthah argues because of theology that the king of the Ammonites is wrong. Everyone at that time, all of them, believed basically that, or lived under the assumption that you only possessed the land, you only had it, if your God had enabled you to do so. Well, Israel's God had obviously given Israel the land that used to belong to the Amorites. So if Chemosh, the god of Moab and Ammon, if he wanted them to have owned that land, he would have given them the victory already. They'd already have it. So he uses their own religious premise to argue that Israel's God, that's why he keeps repeating that phrase, the Lord of Israel, had already given them the land. Now, we can take Jephthah's words in two ways. You know, we can, maybe he has the same worldview that they do, that there really are many gods and his God had given his people that land. Or maybe he was using their worldview to trap them, knowing that there really are no other gods and the God of Israel is the only true God. It's hard to say, but what follows is going to show us in probably the most tragic way possible that Jephthah had at least some pagan ideas about the true God and about how to worship and relate to the true God. Judges hasn't gotten dark yet, as bad as it's been. It's about to get horrible. So the king of Ammon hears all that, doesn't want to be bothered with those pesky things called facts. So we read verse 28. But the king of the Ammonites did not listen to the words of Jephthah that he sent to him. So no diplomacy, only war. Verse 29, then the spirit of the Lord was upon Jephthah, and he passed through Gilead and Manasseh and passed on to Mizpah of Gilead, and from Mizpah of Gilead he passed on to the Ammonites. Verse 30, and Jephthah made a vow to the Lord and said, if you will give the Ammonites into my hand, then whatever comes out from the doors of my house to meet me when I return in peace from the Ammonites shall be the Lord's, and I will offer it up as a burnt offering. Verse 32. So Jephthah crossed over to the Ammonites to fight against them, and the Lord gave them into his hand. And he struck them from Aroer to the neighborhood of Minnith, 20 cities, and as far as Abel Keramim with a great blow, so the Ammonites were subdued before the people of Israel. And that's it. So after all of that, we get basically one sentence in verse 33. So the Ammonites were subdued before the people of Israel. Why is the victory over the oppressing force, it's been 18 years, why is that victory dealt with so quickly in the passage? Almost peripheral, like, yep, they won. Because the author wants all the focus to be on what comes next. Jephthah has done something completely unnecessary that will have horrific consequences. The Spirit of the Lord was upon Jephthah. He was going to win this battle. God was going to give the Ammonites into his hand. Jephthah should have just believed. He should have just had faith, and that should have been enough. He didn't need to try to coax God with a sacrifice if God let him win. That's what he does. That's what you have to do with idols to get them on your side, not with the true God. There is no reason for him to make a vow. There is no reason for you and I, by the way, to make vows. But Jephthah made his vow because he doesn't believe that the victory is his. He doesn't believe the Lord is going to deliver. He thinks he has to hedge his bets a little bit. If you let me win, I'll give you a sacrifice when I get back. With what? It all belongs to the Lord anyway. Why would we barter? What is Jephthah doing? It's what the pagans do. No, when he gets home, if you let me win, God, I'll sacrifice whatever comes out of my house first to greet you. Now notice, it's kind of like, remember Gideon, you know, with the fleece? It's kind of like the same type of scene, but what's the difference here? There's no response whatsoever from God, nothing. God doesn't move him to make the vow. God doesn't say after he's made the vow that, okay, all right, that sounds good to me. If you're going to give me a sacrifice, then I'll let you win the battle. This vow comes from unbelief then. Gideon was trying to Noah, a god to whom he had been a stranger. Jephthah is treating God like all the other gods that are only appeased by sacrifice and works. Again, just like Israel is in the beginning of the text, crying out because they have nowhere else to go. Treating God like one of the idols. They've been so squeezed into the mold of the world that they think of God like they think of their idols. He doesn't know who God is. He doesn't know. Verse 34. Then Jephthah came to his home at Mizpah. He won. And behold, his daughter came out to meet him with tambourines and with dances. She was his only child. Besides her, he had neither son nor daughter. It's about a 12-year-old little girl. My daughter has turned 12 yesterday. Verse 35, and as soon as he saw her, he tore his clothes and said, "Alas, my daughter, you have brought me very low, and you have become the cause of great trouble to me. It was her fault, for I have opened my mouth to the Lord, and I cannot take back my vow." Yes, you can. God didn't require this. And she said to him, "My father, you have opened your mouth to the Lord." It's a devoutly pious little girl. "You have opened your mouth to the Lord. Do to me according to what has gone out of your mouth, now that the Lord has avenged you on your enemies, on the Ammonites." So she said to her father, "Let this thing be done for me. Leave me alone 2 months, that I may go up and down on the mountains and weep for my virginity, I and my companions." Weep for a life she'll never have. Marriage, children, she's going to die young with none of those things. This is Israel we're talking about here. This isn't Moab. This isn't Canaan. This is Israel. So he said in verse 38, "Go." That's all he has to say to his little girl. Then he sent her away for 2 months, and she departed, she and her companions, and wept for her virginity on the mountains. And at the end of 2 months, she returned to her father, who did with her according to his vow that he had made. Now, there are all kinds of ways to try and get Jephthah off the hook. But in verse 31, what does it mean to deal with her according to the vow he had made? From verse 31, he offered his daughter up as a burnt offering. That's what he did to his little girl. She had never known a man, and it became a custom in Israel that the daughters of Israel went year by year to lament the daughter of Jephthah the Gileadite 4 days in the year. In other words, nobody forgot about this. It was awful. Awful. Now, with the exception of one other that comes later, this is probably the worst story from this period in Israel's history. This is the judge. This is one of the deliverers of Israel. So the further away we go from worshiping the one true God, the worse we treat each other. The more the image of God in us is tainted, the more awful our world becomes and what we will do to each other, even fathers to their little daughters. This is Israel. I want to stress that again. God had brought them out of Egypt. They had all the reason to believe and to have faith. He delivered them again and again and again. And by the middle of Judges, you can't tell Israel apart from the Canaanites. The man burned his little girl alive. Jephthah thought God was like all the other gods. So he tried to relate to him like that. And God was dishonored and people were destroyed. We can't save ourselves. Now, I don't know why God didn't intervene. I don't. I have a guess. That's all it is. And since it's a guess, I'm not going to go into it. I don't know why Jephthah went through with it, other than to say something, he went through with it that had something to do with the same reason he made the vow in the first place. I think he thought, if I don't do this, I go back on my word, I get squashed. That's who he thought God was. We could do a whole sermon on the implications of that alone. But let us just say this. If you and I let anything or anyone but Jesus alone shape our picture of who God is, the results will always be tragic. Always. Don't make up your own ideas about God. Don't do it. And don't let the world tell you what God is like. Look to Jesus alone, in whom God has spoken to us once and for all for your picture of God. If you look anywhere else, the results are always horrible. Always. But there's still more tragedy to come. Like we said, Israel is gone. So that brings us to chapter 12, verse 1. The men of Ephraim were called to arms, and they crossed to Zaphon and said to Jephthah, "Why did you cross over to fight against the Ammonites and did not call us to go with you? We will burn your house over you with fire. Ephraim, give it a rest." Remember in chapter 8 when they're mad at Gideon? "You didn't call us to come out and fight with you." So they've changed. They're getting better. Same thing. "You didn't let us come and help you." Verse 2, "And Jephthah said to them, 'I and my people had a great dispute with the Ammonites, and when I called you, you did not save me from their hand. And when I saw that you would not save me, I took my life in my hand and crossed over against the Ammonites, and the Lord gave them into my hand. Why then have you come up to me this day to fight against me?'" So whatever happened, just remember, this guy killed his daughter. Verse 4, "Then Jephthah gathered all the men of Gilead and fought with Ephraim." So what do we have now? Civil war. "And the men of Gilead struck Ephraim because they said, 'You are fugitives of Ephraim, you Gileadites, in the midst of Ephraim and Manasseh.' And the Gileadites captured the fords of the Jordan against the Ephraimites. And when any of the fugitives of Ephraim said, 'Let me go over,' the men of Gilead said to him, 'Are you an Ephraimite?' When he said, 'No,' they said to him, 'Then say Shibboleth.' And he said, 'Sibboleth,' for he could not pronounce it right. Then they seized him," whenever this happened, "and slaughtered him at the fords of the Jordan. At that time, 42,000 of the Ephraimites fell." Jephthah judged Israel 6 years. Then Jephthah the Gileadite died and was buried in his city in Gilead. Ephraim has to have the glory. They jump all over Jephthah for not consulting them. He says, "I did, you didn't come." But Ephraim's pride breaks Israel apart. 42,000 Israelites, 42,000 are killed by Israelites. And that's how Jephthah's scene ends. The death of his daughter, civil war, 42,000 Israelites killed by Israelites. So Ammon is subdued. Their oppressor is gone, but Jephthah's little girl is dead. Israelites are killing Israelites. So whether it was Jephthah's excessive zeal, Ephraim's excessive pride, the whole victory now over Ammon, rather than there being this glorious time of restful peace in the Lord, the whole victory is tainted by human foolishness and human arrogance. There are lessons God means to teach to us about the beauty and the sufficiency of his son Jesus in the midst of all this tragedy. How does this text speak into our lives? What is there for us to hear? Let's bring out three things this morning, three implications of what we've just read. Number one, idolatry leads to slavery, and slavery leads to idolatry. Idolatry leads to slavery, and slavery leads to idolatry. Now, when this text began, right, it began with this list of all the gods that Israel left the one true God in order to worship. Now, again, as you're reading, start asking questions of the passage. There had to be reasons for that. There had to be reasons Israel chose to go after other gods again and again. Why do we worship things other than God? And honestly, the question is just as big for us as it would have been for Israel. It's very easy for us in our modern context to think of idolatry as this sin you could only commit in the ancient world, right? You could only, idols are, that's something very specific. You're talking about gods like Chemosh and Baal and the Ashtoreth. And so that's a sin that's kind of removed from us. But then by the power of the Holy Spirit in Romans chapter 1, verses 18 through 31, you don't have to turn there, just mark it down to read. Paul reveals that all sin, all of it, no matter what it is, can be characterized as one thing: idolatry, the worship of false gods. So the definition of sin is worshiping something other than God. That's what all sin is, regardless if it expresses itself as like a lie or the loss of a temper or lust or a sinful relationship of some kind. It doesn't matter what the fruit of it is. The root of all sin is idolatry. Israel was just giving us pictures with these specific examples of what all humankind would do and does. Israel's behavior in Judges is a picture of humanity's behavior all day, every day, everywhere, all the time, in every time. That's what Judges is. And again, it doesn't matter. It could be a good thing. A good thing can be an idol. Those are the dangerous ones. But if our hearts desire something or someone more than God, we're idolaters. We're controlled, Paul says in Romans 1, by the lusts of our hearts. The overwhelming, enslaving, uncontrollable desires that shape our lives. And as you see in Judges, we find the same thing in Romans 1. In judgment, God gives us up to those things. God gives us to be ruled by those things we want so badly. So idolatry leads to slavery. Slavery to what we worship. Remember what God said to Israel when they cried out. He says, no, let the gods you serve deliver you. Let those things that you worship, they're your gods, get help from them. You wouldn't worship them if they couldn't help you, so go get help from them now. Go see how merciful they are. Go see how powerful they are. Go see how faithful they are. Go see how satisfying they are. Human hearts have not changed between Judges and right now. The idols just have different names. Those things we hope in instead of God, he will cause those things, even the good ones. Because no matter how good they aren't God revealed in his son, Jesus. He will cause those things to become the ruling power in our lives. We'll become the slaves of what we worship. But here's the thing. No matter how they hurt us, no matter how often things other than God and people other than God let us down and don't deliver us and don't deliver what we've craved from them, we keep going back to them. We keep going back to the same things. We keep worshiping them. And so slavery leads back to idolatry. When Israel worshiped the gods of another nation, that nation ended up oppressing them and enslaving them, but they kept going back to them. What does that tell us about them? What does it tell me about me when I do the same thing? It tells us that whatever these false gods promised Israel, security, comfort, prosperity, stability, they wanted it, and they wanted it more than God, and they didn't think God could provide them with those things. So as much as idolatry leads to slavery, slavery leads back to idolatry. It's a vicious cycle. We can't free ourselves from it. Idols give us nothing, but because our desire for what they promise is so strong, we keep going back to them. Lives are just continually broken because no matter what we hear, Jesus isn't enough. And it's usually, again, it's usually the good things. No. This has to work out too. Then we end up relating to God like Jephthah did. For example, if we seek our value and our purpose in relationships, so we sacrifice everything to get the marriage that we want or whatever, and that marriage fails, our natural response is usually what? I need to find another relationship. I need to find a better spouse, a better blank. Idols are so poisonous that they make us think worshiping me is not the problem. It's that you're not worshiping me enough. So get more. Get more money. Get more recognition. Get more drugs. Get a better spouse. God turns us over to what we crave, and we become so enslaved to what we want that we want it more. He's trying to break us out of the cycle, and we won't have it. In essence, God says to us in this giving up over to what we want to worship, look, if you want to live for the approval of people instead of me, then the approval of people will run your life. It will control your heart and your emotions. If you want another God besides me, go ahead and let's see how merciful that God is to you. How effective it is in saving you and guiding you and enlightening you and giving you peace. God has very intentionally revealed himself as the only thing, the only person that can actually deliver on that promise. We go after everything but God to be happy and satisfied. We never end up actually happy or actually satisfied. But we continue to think that true happiness and true satisfaction will come apart from him. How come it never works? For much the same reason that no matter how strong or how able or how powerful Israel's judges were, they were unable to fully save Israel. So there are no true gods among us. There are no true saviors here. There isn't an idol that can save. There isn't an idol that can deliver. Everything but God revealed to us in Jesus is a tainted savior. That's point two. Idols are tainted saviors. What is so appealing? Why does Israel keep doing this? You would think they would learn. You would think we would learn. So why do we get caught up in the same cycle? Idols prey on the desires of our hearts for everything other than God. There's a great book, works like a commentary, called What the Old Testament Authors Really Cared About. An excellent book pointing everything to Christ by a guy named Jason DeRucci. And he gives seven, in his work on Judges, he gives seven reasons why idols are so attractive to us. So he seeks to answer that question. First, they're guaranteed. An idol in Israel's world then was a visible, tangible, physical representation that was considered to transmit the presence of a deity. You could see it. It was there. So idols are physical and they're visible. Have you ever prayed and felt like God wasn't there? Have you ever prayed and just felt like you were talking to the ceiling? Have you ever been asking for something and asking and asking and asking and there's no answer? Well, an idol then will have immediate appeal. It's right there. Drugs are there. People are there. Images are there. Accessible, physical. You can reach out and touch it, sometimes even get immediate gratification. They're guaranteed. Second, they're selfish and works-oriented. So idols could always be fed by offerings in the ancient world. They could be, you could go through all the ceremonies. People believe those offerings obligated whatever god it was to multiply their crops, multiply their fertility, multiply their cattle. So worship was really driven by the pursuit of earthly profit or pleasure. Blessing from the god was a wage that you paid for by your worship. It's a tragedy when we treat God that way, by the way. A tragedy. So idols are materialistic and legalistic. Are you ever prone to self-righteousness? Have you ever been tempted with materialism? Idols appeal to that desire in us, not only to be recognized, but to prosper and to get gain. Third, idols are easy. Idols called for frequent and generous outward offerings or sacrifices. Yes, they did. But the condition of your heart, how you felt about them or about people, was irrelevant. You didn't have to have any covenantal or heart-generated obligations to other people. That wasn't just pay your dues and get your blessing and go on with life. It's all relative with idols. There are no real binding obligations on my heart. I can check in and check out whenever I want. You ever find it easier to please men rather than God? Isn't that easier? Or to love yourself rather than other people? Fourth, idols are convenient. And again, there were frequent and generous offerings expected, but the wares and the winds were up to you, or up to the worshiper. You could pick what you wanted. Idols are everywhere, anywhere, anytime. You know, they're just there. Whatever you want to be an idol becomes an idol. Whatever you want to worship, you can worship. Do you ever find that submitting your life completely to God in all things gets in the way of your own agenda? Well, then create a God that won't get in the way of your own agenda. Create a God that will serve your agenda. Fifth, idols are normal. Worshiping things other than God was the way of life in the ancient world, just like it is now, right? Well, Israel had the minority view back then, that there was one God over all who redeemed a people for a relationship with himself. Well, that was and still is, maybe even more, extremely odd and abnormal to believe. That there is one God who's created everything, that has chosen to redeem a people for himself. So are you ever prone to follow the crowd, even if you know the majority is wrong? Well, idols are normal. Everybody's doing it. Everybody decides for themselves what's worthy of worship. Sixth, idols are logical. This is the point he makes here is great. The idols are logical. Ancient people believed in three categories of gods. You had personal, family, and national. Now, the various gods were specialists then in certain areas. You had gods of war, gods of weather, gods of fertility, gods of grain. Yahweh, Israel's God, was one God over everything. Israel worshiped him nationally, but then used these specialized gods for the specific issues in everyday life. God is the God over me, but if I want the weather to go my way or this thing to go my way, I need to pray to blank. I need to have blank. When you're sick, when something's really wrong, would you rather see a specialist or a general practitioner? Idols are closer, they're more relevant, they're more logical than a God who is above all things and has to manage everything. And it doesn't always seem like God is the solution to the specific issues that I face. That's way too abstract. You know, I don't need God, I need this thing, right? Idols are logical. And then seventh, finally, idols are sensuous. It's a no-brainer. They're focused on what is earthly and fleshly and physical. You can feel them, right? They provide something that's pleasurable. Have you ever turned away from God for worldly pleasures? If it feels good, do it, right? These are at least some of the reasons idols have any appeal. And here's the thing. Israel wanted things that they didn't think God could or would provide. So they worshiped gods who they thought would be better at giving them what they wanted. That's idolatry. We can create all kinds of names for it, break it down however we want to. That's the essence of what idolatry is. Especially among us that know God. The problem is that they're tainted. Idols are tainted saviors. Nothing that they give can last. Nothing. Most of what they promise, they have no power to deliver anyway. So tainted saviors give tainted salvation. And when you translate that into the Christian community where we worship God and God is our God, and remember, like we were saying, you would check Christianity on the box of what your religion is. But where you really find hope and really find peace and really find life is in all the lower things that if you live right enough, he'll give them to you. No wonder there's so much brokenness and despair and hopelessness. We're going after tainted saviors and we have tainted salvation, but we keep buying into the lie because the Lord hasn't transformed. He hasn't gotten a hold of our hearts. He's just legal and national. Makes no sense for us to keep feasting on things that can't satisfy us. Makes no sense for us to keep hoping in things that can't rescue us. It makes no sense to keep trying to find happiness in things that can't deliver lasting joy, but our desires rule over us. There are people that when they hear the truth of the gospel say, no, that there we used to have, my dad had a taekwondo school that worked out of the church where I was when I was younger, and he taught on donation only, so there was no dues or anything. So we had a lot of folks come in and train and learn taekwondo from us that didn't go to church. But at the end of every class, my dad would do like a gospel presentation or share a devotional. And there was one guy that came for years and years and trained with us, just for years and years, and heard that over and over and over and over again. We were back in the changing room getting after class was over one time, and it was just me, my dad, and this guy. And my dad said, "Can I ask you something?" I don't want to say his name. He said, "Can I ask you something, man? Why do you keep rejecting the gospel? Just level with me. Why do you keep saying no to it?" And he said, "Oh, I don't want to stop looking at women." At least he was honest. I mean, but think about the horrible exchange he was making. But he didn't know. He couldn't see that. Our desires rule over us, and we can't help but believe ourselves. And so the world then, in the time of the judges, and the world now, is the result of what happens when people seek for satisfaction in a billion different things that can never give it. That's why the world was the way it was then. That's why the world is the way it is now. The world then and the world now are what happens when the saviors are tainted. If Israel wanted true salvation that wasn't tainted, it would have to look somewhere other than false gods. We're going to have to look somewhere other than Jephthah or Gideon or whoever it was. And if we want perfect salvation, if we want true peace and true life and true satisfaction, we'll have to look to something greater than every other savior we could imagine. That's what Judges is showing us again and again and again. Jesus Christ, this is point three. Jesus Christ is the only untainted Savior. The only untainted Savior. So as Judges continues, every deliverer wins Israel a great victory, but they don't save Israel. We can't save ourselves. Jephthah won a great battle, but look at how marred and how tainted that salvation is. Judges is the Lord telling us that true deliverance, true peace, true salvation cannot come from tainted saviors. And here's the thing. Salvation is not just God delivering us from his wrath. And praise God forever that it is primarily that. But that's not all it is. Salvation is also God freeing us from believing our own lies. Salvation is God breaking the cycle of idolatry and slavery and idolatry and slavery with himself. Israel had to embrace a savior they once had rejected in Jephthah. What did the world do with its only savior? Cast him out, rejected him, but he's all there is. So there's nothing more tragic in humanity than its rejection of its only savior and its only satisfier. So the call to repent of our sins and ask for forgiveness and believe and give our lives to Jesus is not just a call to be made right with God. It's a call from God to you to never be unsatisfied again. Jesus is the only untainted Savior. And the call to come to him is a call to unending, everlasting happiness. That's what it is. 2 weeks ago, we talked about how God's desire to be glorified and my desire to be satisfied meet in worship. So those two great longings in the universe, God's desire to be glorified, my desire, which obvious from the Bible, it's obvious our biggest desire is to be satisfied. Those two things come together in the worship of God. They come together when through Jesus, God becomes the object of my worship and the source of my satisfaction. Now that idea, there's an author, a preacher named John Piper, says it this way. God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. I think that's very biblical. God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. But, now, or say, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Isn't that kind of selfish, though? That I go to him for satisfaction. I mean, how can it be right to seek my satisfaction? Isn't that what's wrong with the world in the first place? That's what you said, right? That we all seek our own satisfaction. We're all after what will make us happy. And isn't Christianity all about self-denial? Not being satisfied, but denying yourself. That's how Jesus talked all the time. It sounds like you're trying to twist it and make it into some other kind of way to get yourself satisfied. The problem with the world is actually not that it's trying to find happiness and satisfaction. That's not what I said. God made us for that. God made us for worship. The problem with the world is that it's trying to find happiness and satisfaction in everything but God. And yes, following Jesus is self-denial. But how should we define self-denial biblically? I think if we listen to Jesus, you find that when he talks about self-denial, what he's saying to us again and again and again, not in some secret way, but right in front of us, deny yourself everything that won't ever save or satisfy you and have me. That's the self-denial Jesus is talking about all through Scripture. Deny yourself tin to have gold. Deny yourself moldy bread to have the bread of life. When Israel is sinning in Jeremiah chapter 2, be appalled, O heavens, the Lord is speaking, be shocked, be utterly desolate, says the Lord, for my people have committed two great evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living water, and have hewed out for themselves cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. What's the definition of evil in Israel? They turned their back on living water for broken cisterns. They could have had me, and they took that. That's how Jesus talks. Matthew 13:44. The way Jesus talks, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy, he went and sold everything he had to buy that field. That's self-denial. Give everything you have away. Give it all away. Deny yourself all those things to buy this field and know me. Mark 8:34-36. Listen to Jesus speaking. If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself. There it is. Let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Full stop, right? Deny yourself. Wait. Keep reading. Listen to Jesus. So here's why you deny yourself. For whoever would save his life will lose it. Did you hear that logic? What's the actual call in denying yourself? Saving your life, not losing it. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake in the Gospels will save it. Look at how he's arguing. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? Do you hear the Savior? Do you hear what he's saying? Disciples, don't lose your life. Don't throw it away on nothing. Die and save it. Don't lose it. Keep it. That's what he's saying. Do you want a profit? Then have me instead of the whole world. And trust me, you'll profit forever. That's the way Jesus argues. We think it's all about just, I'm going to grit my teeth and never sin for the next 30 days. Well, all right. Or feast on Jesus and be happy and go love people. Says you could get the whole world, it's nothing compared with me. So if you want to live, if you want to gain, if you want to profit, come to me. That's what he says. That's how he argues. Jesus is the only untainted Savior. So whether Israel was sincere in its repentance in 10:15 or not, what they say there in essence needs to be the cry of our heart towards God. Look, regardless of whether I ever get this or that, Lord, whether you ever give me what I want you. Be my portion, Lord, forever. Be everything to me, whether I ever get anything else. Now, when that happens, When our hearts are being transformed like that, then we're free to enjoy everything, every good thing God has given to us as much as we want. The Bible doesn't call you to be stoic and ascetic and not enjoy anything. The Bible says that looks like wisdom, but it's not. And we keep trying to be more righteous than God and smarter than Paul and say, no, you don't understand. You got to pull away from all that or it'll kill you. And he says, look, that looks like wisdom, but it isn't. There's no value in it in stopping the indulgence of your flesh. If we would just listen to the Bible, listen to Paul, by the power of the Holy Spirit telling us, if you make the object of your religion, your willpower and your grit and your righteousness, that won't satisfy. There's no power in that to break the yoke of slavery in you. Only Jesus offers that. I won't find that in myself. I won't find that in what I can create to be righteous. I'll only find the peace that frees me from the power of sin in Jesus. Only in him. If we treat God like the wooden, solemn, stoic, right thing, okay, and I'm almost done. If we say to God, look, what I really want and what I really love is this thing. What I really want and really love is that thing. But it's right to choose you, then I'll choose you. We belittle him if that's what's in our hearts. Try that in a marriage. See if piety and doing the right thing would work if it was like this. Let's say, now I'm not, but let's say I went to my wife and said, babe, I talked to her about this last night, making sure it was okay if I... But imagine that I said, amen, thank you. Imagine if I said to her, listen, honey, I've been seeing somebody else. And that girl is way more attractive than you are. And I like everything about her a million times more than I like basically anything about you. And I really want to be with her. If I could do what I wanted, I would be with her. But you know what? Sweetheart, I made you a promise. And I don't want to break it. So I'll stay with you. Exactly. Exactly. If we treat Jesus like that, we belittle him, just like I'd be horribly belittling my wife and exalting my promise-making power or promise-keeping power. Do you see that? If we're saying, look, here's what's really big here. I'm going to do the right thing. If that's all God wanted, we're still under the law, and the Pharisees are the best thing we could ever be. Why did God destroy that system and blow it into smithereens? Why did he do that? Because he wasn't trying to be followed like some big grandpa with a beard in the sky that's going to smash you all the time. That's not who he is. That's not even how he talks about himself. If following Jesus is just a matter of duty, just buckling down and doing the right thing and virtuously denying yourself what you really want because you're a Christian, then all your righteousness belittles God and exalts your self-denial. Deny yourself the world to have Jesus. Drink him in. He's all we have, and I'm telling you, he is more than enough. Only he will last. Only he will satisfy. Jesus doesn't just talk in those kinds of metaphors to be flowery. He means them. Idols will kill us. They've fooled us into thinking they can satisfy without ever having done it. Our souls were made to feast on Jesus, and until we do, until in our hearts, everything we can enjoy is a road that leads us to him and not the destination, we will only keep repeating the cycles in our lives that destroy us. So come to Jesus. Be reconciled with God. Come to him and have abundant life forever. He's better. He's better. He's the only untainted Savior. Let's pray. Our Father, we're thankful today for your Son. We're thankful, Lord, for what he has accomplished for us and then transferred to us as our righteousness with which we stand before you now, which is why we always stand approved and justified and not condemned because of Jesus for us and over us and in us and through us. So Lord, would you teach us now not just to believe, but to be satisfied in him. Lord, would you keep us from the burden that can come from that and getting it mixed up and thinking that it would be wrong to enjoy anything. No, Lord, we glorify you by enjoying what you have given as it points us back to you. And so, Lord, would you help us? Would you keep our eyes on you? Help me to live what I preach. Help me to embrace this as the truth that it is, as you've revealed it in your word. And this I ask for my sake and for the sake of everyone in this room, that Jesus Christ would be our treasure. In his name we pray, amen.
Thanks again for joining us. And if you have any questions about today's recording, Gateway Church, or what it means to follow Jesus Christ, you can reach us through the contact section of our website, gwbrawley.org.